everybody, and welcome to the Sisay deck tech video, the deck with a mass amount of 60 creatures in it. But this video is also going to be a tier 1 con Sisay review, how she actually performed during that tournament. So if we just take a look at the deck list, here we can see that we have Sisay, we have 59 creatures, 4 artifacts, 3 enchantments, 32 lands, and 1 planeswalker Teferi Time Reveler. Actually, so one thing, I'm gonna begin with cutting Oath of Nissa and add Ragavan to this list because I didn't have Ragavan as a card when I went to the tournament and I couldn't proxy that one. So Ragavan is really expensive and I didn't want to purchase it, so Oath of Nissa was basically a replacement, but Ragavan is what should be in the deck instead. It's a lot of creatures, guys. And that takes us to the very first important thing we need to mention, and that is that this is actually a really bad deck. This kind of deck with 60 creatures shouldn't work. You see, this kind of creature heavy deck is really glass canny to a board wipe. You simply lose everything you've built up and you need to rebuild, and that is very bad. So there's just one of these that basically solve the entire game plan. Just one overloaded Psycrypt, and we're back to the Stone Age. Then something very, very interesting happened. People started to cut these cards. I mean, I have been in games where people cast Demonic Tutor and I go, oh no, Cyclonic Overload. And they reply with, I don't actually have that inside my deck. And the reason behind that is because there aren't that many creature heavy decks and there aren't that many stacks decks running around in every metagame. The metagame have been filled with a lot of Turbo Odnos combos, and Psycrypts and board wipes aren't really good versus those. The only one I kinda run into is Culling Ritual, because it's actually some form of a ritual for the Odnos decks as well. I have heard that people have a Damn in their deck because Damn is a damn good card. However, I've actually never seen anyone try to cast it or put it onto the stack in any of my games, even though they actually have it inside their deck. I'm yet to experience it. It should happen eventually. So I thought, let's actually be greedy. Let's actually do it. Let's build the ultimate creature heavy Sisay deck. And truth be told, I absolutely got away with it. We're gonna talk a little bit later in the video on how this deck performed during the tier 1 con. But it is important that you know that board wipes just wrecks this deck completely, and I don't actually think this is a deck that is viable because it's just so glass cannony. But if your metagame doesn't involve board wipes and people are cutting Psycrypts, you are gonna get away with this Creature Storm deck of this. But why is the creature mass just so good? Well, I have made some videos in the past on how Bloom Tender is a one card combo that is being fueled with mass creature count. You see, Sisay's combos work better the more creatures you actually have. For example, you might have seen a video where I talk about this amazing combo that just gets better and better the more random whatever legendary creatures you have inside your deck. So Sisay gets more consistent and faster the more creature you put into it, especially legendaries, but creature will do the job anyway, but legendary the better. But if we go back here and take a look at this, notice that I don't have a single instant or sorcerer inside the entire deck. And if we look at the enchantments, we have a Carpet of Flower, a Deafening Silence, no Mystic Remora, and artifacts, Chromox, Mana Crypt, Mox Diamond, Sol Ring. No Demonic Tutor, no counter spells at all. Like, wouldn't this deck benefit heavily from Demonic Tutor, Court of Calling, or cards like Neoform, creature tutors, right? So for those that don't know, Dockside Extortionist is a one card combo for this deck. And wouldn't it be great to use a Court of Calling in instant speed to find the Crazy Goblin, or a Demonic Tutor to find the Goblin, or a Neoform Sacrificing a Dork to find the Goblin? This is gonna sound a little bit strange, but the deck is already so consistent that you don't really need to consistently be able to find your Dockside. The amount of combos inside this deck that is layering together are so many that all you really need is just mana and a little bit of a card draw here and there, and you're going to figure it out. And the thing with Sisay is that she is basically your card draw. She is going to find the pieces that you need, and she just needs mana to do that, and then everything is solved. At first glance, when people often look at this deck, they usually think that Darevin Nigella is the main plan A combo for this deck. Actually, it isn't. It's like the Plan E combo, I think. I actually never really won a game with Darevin Nigella. It's very rare to get there. This is actually the main combo. This is the easiest fastest and really consistent combo that you can assemble. All that you really need is to find Darevi somewhere down the line in someone's end step. You get Darevi in play, you attack with your creatures, and here's why creature mass is great for this deck, because all of your creatures turns into mana dorks, and if you're able to get two CC activations that turn because of that Darevi boost, you're going to find Gaia's Cradle and Emil the Blessed, and then you simply tap Gaia's Cradle and you activate Emil, and boom, you have infinite mana, and then you can use the infinite green mana from Gaia's Cradle with your mass creature count to basically untap your lands, your Bird of Paradise, your Mox Diamonds, everything that taps for all forms of colors. You have infinite mana, infinite CC activations, and do whatever you want. But then that Nigella Darevi combo is something you just layer into if someone kills Emil or someone uses an Assassin's Trophy on your Gaia's Cradle. And if someone for some reason kills Darevi, then you layer into this combo with Nigella, Ezika, and Kinnan. Actually, all that you really need is Kinnan and Ezika. There's a video up there in the top right corner you can look at too, that explains this combo. It's a very good one. And this is actually the like plan B combo I usually go for, even before I go for this combo. So by not running these tutors, we have more space for more layering combos that just flow together with each other in various combinations. But also, by not playing these cards means that we're not affected by a great majority of various counter spells. Now, Pact of Negation actually deals with creatures, but Flusterstorm, only instants of sorceries, Fierce Guardianship, non-creature spells only, Force of Negation, non-creature spells only, and Deflecting Sword that is great in counter spells wars doesn't really affect us that much either. So we can really just put creature combos into play, pass priority and say, do you have a response? And they can sit with all their Fierce Guardianship they want, it's not gonna do anything. I have won games where people are having a stacked hand with Flusterstorm variants and they can't interact. But if we are using our Demonic Tutor to find that Dockside Extortionist, our opponents are going to use their Flusterstorm to counter that Demonic Tutor, because they know that we're gonna find a creature that they can't interact with, so they have to counter the tutor instead of countering what the tutor finds. This is something that people miss when they haven't played much against Sisay, but people that know Sisay, they do counter the tutor, Demonic Tutor. But there is another thing. By not having these tutors, our opponents won't consume their interaction that doesn't affect us, but will affect their other opponents, which means that we're leaving the weapons that we want our opponents to have in their hand, because like you can have an opponent with infinite Flusterstorms in their hand, like 10 Flusterstorms, and you won't care. That's actually really good. I want to emphasize that. It is strangely good to have an opponent with 10 Flusterstorms in their hand, because that means that that opponent will be very capable of interacting with your other opponents that are usually Turbo Nos. You might have heard of a term called sandbagging, which basically means that you have interaction in your hand, but you're passing priority because you are letting your other opponents deal with that threat. Basically just sandbagging. And this is truly the greatest sandbag deck in the entire world, because it basically passes on everything. It doesn't really care. Now, the last resource we have is activating Sisay and figuring something out. But we are truly passing on most things in the entire world because we don't care about any... We're gonna get to that part later. We truly don't care about any stacks. We're gonna talk about opposition agent at this deck very soon. But we are passing on everything your opponents are doing that is grindy card draw, stacks, and the only thing we kind of interact with is when someone is trying to combo off and win, and that is where we're relying on CC activation. Everything else, the opponents can consume their counter spells. We don't care. We sandbag. I said something really strange there. Passing priority and ignoring all forms of card draw action. You see, CC has the best matchup ever versus greedy mid-range decks, because she has one of the strongest ultimate secret weapons that is actually getting interacted with, because people have kind of figured this one out. But she can fetch Teferi's Time Reveler in your last opponent's end step, basically saying you can have infinite Abrupt Decays in your hand, you can have infinite Frosted Storms in your hand, I don't care, I'm gonna win on my turn and you can't interact with me. So she's really good versus decks that are trying to just draw cards and accumulate value in their hand. But this deck can also be called a five-colored Kinnan deck. You see, Sisay has an amazing grind potential in long games versus these mid-range decks because of the fact that we have a Kinnan as a backup. Now, a lot of you have been asking me how I feel about opposition agent that is completely destroying Sisay, making Sisay pretty much useless. My response to opposition agent is basically, I don't care. Now, I am not going to interact with opposition agent. Something I said previously in this video is, we ignore and pass on all stacks your opponents are doing because we are figuring out how we can play through them. And Kinnan is the answer. Kinnan is a combo piece that we can win with. Kinnan is a value engine that produces more mana with Sisay, more CC activation. That is great. But Kinnan is a solution to the opposition agent as well. If we have our CC in play, or well, let's just say there's an opposition agent in play, we're not gonna cast Sisay, we're gonna draw into, let's go Kinnan, or let's go T-Balt, this crazy cosmic imposter, and we can just sit and activate T-Balt or sit and activate Kinnan instead, and grinding through the game. You see, that opposition agent is also hurting some other opponents as well. And if we interact with the opposition agent, we are opening the game for those two opponents. So we rather sit back and let everyone suffer, including ourselves, but being capable of basically ignoring it and play through the game anyway. We also have Ezekiah's other version, the Prismatic Bridge, which isn't like great, but it's a tiny something if for some reason we can't utilize Ezekiah or Sisay. We also have a Grenzo Havoc Razor to card draw a tiny bit and shred our opponent's decks into pieces. Remember, this is a creature heavy deck and we are attacking a lot with this deck. Speaking of combat, this deck can also be called a five-colored Venota deck. We're playing a huge amount of humans that we can attack into play. Also, this deck can be called a five-colored Grenzel Dungeon Warden. We're playing 60 creatures. You usually need to have him as a 4-4. 3-3 will usually do the work too, but a 4-4 is usually better. And Grenzel will basically put almost all forms of creatures from your bottom of library into play. He is actually really effective in this deck. And honestly, if you have him in your hand, probably cast Grenzo instead of casting Sisay. He is a powerhouse of bursting value into play. You can be a little bit unlucky, but mostly you're going to really make the deck explode. We also have a Vizier of the Menagerie. We could truly call this deck a five-colored Vizier of the Menagerie. With that really high creature count inside this deck, 60 creatures, the ratio of being lucky having a creature on top of your library with the Vizier is really good. Also, this deck can also be called a five-colored Yisan the Wandering Bard. If you have your Yisan, your Mana Crypt, that's a turn one Yisan, and that can be really scary. There are some really crazy cards inside this deck that you can Yisan can find. For example, Gilded Drake. Some of you are gonna say Dockside here, but I'm actually gonna say Grand Abolisher. You're gonna take your turn, you're gonna activate Yisan, and you're gonna find Grand Abolisher, and you're gonna win, even though your opponent has a lot of interaction inside their hand. Also, we can find Grand Abolisher with a Venota attack trigger, and then basically win on that turn in the attack step. But here I have probably the craziest creature of them all, usually because people just basically ignore it. They think it's pretty slow and weak, and then you get to sit around and do crazy things with it. So, Arcane Artisan. Target player draws a card, then exiles a card from their hand. If a creature card is exiled this way, that player creates a token of that creature. When Arcane Artisan leaves the battlefield, exile all tokens with it that it has created at the beginning of the end next end step. So you're gonna keep all your creatures this turn cycle. Now, a lot of people are usually saying, I should have killed that Arcane Artisan a long time ago. I have won games with this because it gets away sitting near us, putting creatures into play, drawing cards, and then basically putting a Grand Abolisher into play or a Hatebear into play at instant speed. They can't interact with this. You say, activate Arcane Artisan. with a small smile on your face. And they say, okay, sure, do your worst. You draw a card and you put Grand Abolisher into play. And they aren't allowed to do anything because Grand Abolisher will be in play before they actually have a chance of having priority. This is gonna sound strange, but this is where Yisan is actually a little bit weak because he is calculatable. He is a combo that people can look at and say, you have the win on your turn. Interaction, kill Yisan. Because Yisan is search. He will 100% get whatever I want. And then my opponents can basically sit there and just do the math and calculate that, okay, the Sisay player is going to win, so let's kill Sisay or let's kill Yisan. But these things aren't calculatable. They are random. We could fizzle or we could get our combo. Here's the thing. With a high amount of layering combos that I mentioned before, and with a high amount of creatures, these things become really consistent and they actually let us get there in secret. People are usually sitting here saying, sure, you can value on and oops, you were able to assemble a combo by random chance. That actually brings a fun side to this deck, meaning that your games are very unique and not that repetitive. You see, my normal games with Sisay is that she gets killed, counterspelled, or interacted with in some form of way, and I can't utilize Sisay. But sometimes I get to play with Sisay, I get to do the Sisay game plan, fetching, searching, and toolboxing my way to victory. But sometimes I have to rely on the deck's quality at grinding and basically figure something out with the random things that could occur. And I personally like that. I like when the games are different from each other, when it's not repetitively the same thing over and over again. So, how did this deck actually perform at the tier 1 con? I got into top 16 and I lost to the person who won the entire tournament. Let's begin with the group stage. 5 games, from those I won 3 and I lost 2. And I didn't go to draw in any of my games. I either won or lost. But let's talk about the opponents that I had, because that is also important in evaluating the deck's power level. So most of the decks that I went up against were grindy mid-range or stacksy variants. Some of them were really good at trying to combo off really fast, and then there were a few turbo combo decks there as well, but most were grindy control stacks decks. There were some storm decks here and there, but there was always a pod that I had a other control deck with me. And once again, this is absolutely where Sisay is incredibly amazing. If I have a, let's say, blue farm turbo combo deck against me, and I have another stacks or another control mid-range decks, that's a really good pod for Sisay. If I'm going up against 3 blue farm decks, I don't know. I can win those games. It really depends on what they draw and how they react and how they threat assess my stacks pieces, basically. I didn't see a single board wipe placed on the stack. So my prediction of basically no board wipes were pretty good. And in general, the tournament contained a lot of mixed decks with a huge variety, and I think Sisay, this version of Sisay, is very strong at playing at a mixed variation, because the deck can really adapt to various situations. If you want to stack, so you can put stack pieces into play. If you want to grind and accumulate more value because you don't think you need to do more stacks, you can draw cards and do things like that instead. There was a game of these 3 wins that I actually should have lost, because the person it was basically a misplay. I don't want to go into detail, but it was a small big misplay. However, in the end, this game is about skill, and I played that game really well. So in the end, playing well means you deserve to win. Misplay equals you deserve to lose. But one of the 2 games that I lost, I probably should have won. The game went this. I put a Daffy Voidwalker into play at turn 1. And up against me, I have a Inala deck and a Teshar deck. And those decks can't play versus an anti-graveyard, basically. Now, the Inala deck decides to destroy my Daffy Voidwalker. Even though the Inala deck isn't currently trying to go for a graveyard combo at the moment, which means that the entire game plan just opens for the Teshar player, and then the Teshar player basically wins a few turns later. The Inala player actually said that, I think I made a misplay. Sorry guys for what I did. I kind of opened the game for the Teshar player. And if he wouldn't have done that, my value engine that I was trying to go for would probably get there and potentially secure a win. I think I had a really good matchup in that game. It was just destroyed that the T'Char player got such a great advantage in speed compared to everyone else. And this is how the top 16 went. Basically, if you win top 16, you go to top 4. If you win top 4, you win the entire thing. If you lose in top 16, you're out. This is basically how the game went. Coded Codex is the starting player, comes into play at turn 2 with a Yule Lotus. Pass turn, everyone puts a Mana Dork into play and pass back to Codex turn 2. That basically combos off and win on turn 2. And no one else is getting a turn 2. I actually had a Linval Azorius Renegade in my opening 7 that I could have had into play at turn 2. I actually mulliganed away that hand because I predicted that Cody would probably win on turn 2 and I needed something in play turn 1 before that. I basically were mulliganing for basically Lavinia Azorius Renegade again or Dranite again together with a Mana Crypt or Chromox or Mox Diamond, basically just getting it into play turn 1. But I didn't get that. I actually had it again on turn 2, but I had mulligan turn to 6 and I didn't want to mulligan more. There was also another player there that also had a Dranite in his hand for turn 2. So basically, if the turn order were different, would have been a completely different game, but it was just one game. I'm not sitting here and saying that Sick Robot doesn't deserve to win or that Cody is weak and we just didn't have our turn 2 or there's something wrong with the game. It's just how it is. There are games that I win on turn 3 before anyone else has a turn 2 or turn 2 or anything of that sort as well. In general, I think if you're gonna run tournaments, if you wanna find the best win, the best player, the best deck, you should probably play a lot of games. There are other tournaments that are doing up to 12 games, and I think that is a better aim at finding the best player. But in the end, big congratulations, Sick Robot, you do deserve the game. Sometimes you have that god tier hand and your opponents aren't able to catch up. It's just how the game goes. I don't really feel bad losing to that either. I mean, I did the right choice. I mulliganed away my Lavinia Azorius Renegade turn 2 because I wanted a one better. I think I played... The right answer would have been to mulligan to 5 and just hope for the best. But in the end, you're kind of mulliganing away. I mean, it's a risky thing to do. I could mulligan down to 4 and sit in a really terrible state and just throw away the game of mulliganing against something I'm scared of, so it just wasn't my day. As a finalized word, I definitely think that Sisay has a lot of potential. It is definitely a deck that can go to a tournament and perform well. But the version that I've been showcasing in this video is a Please Don't Board Wipe version. I think I'm gonna change the name to Please Don't Board Wipe. Sisay 5 color, Please Don't Board Wipe. Hope you liked the video, guys. Take care, and I'll see you next time.
Thank you so much for watching and I hope you enjoyed the video. If you like what I do and you wanna support me, feel free to share my videos or even checking out my Patreon page. Also, purchasing cards from the TCG Players website using the affiliate link in the description below of the video will also help the channel grow. So a big thank you to all of you.